Distinguished leaders of the profession at the branch level, Rajesh and Shanmugam and his colleagues in the branch managing committee, at the regional council level, CA Jalapati, at the central council level, CA Sri Priya Kumar, and former leaders of the profession and my good friends and well-wishers, CA Arjun Raj, CA Priya Bansali, and CA Shanmugam Sundaram. Respected senior members and other esteemed colleagues of my profession. It gives me immense pleasure to be here this fine morning to talk to you on the topic of current importance to the profession on a generic basis at the macro level, and also inaugurate this one-day seminar of the Coimbatore branch. Rajesh mentioned that he was very keen that I must come and participate in Coimbatore branch program before 15th August, because I'll be laying down my office as chairman of Canara Bank after that. I don't know 15th August whether it is freedom for the bank or freedom for me or India. But one consolation is, in Canara Bank we have not lent to borrowers who have migrated to London. So that is a matter of consolation. See, when the invitation came to occupy as chairman, non-executive chairman of Canara Bank, many advised me that this is not the right time to be a banker, to be in the banking sector. It's true, in one sense it is true. Because when I used to read Kambaramayanam those days, I remember Kambar mentioning, Kadan Pattar Nenjam Pol Kalanginan Ilangai Vendu. If Kambar had to write Ramayana today, he would have written Kadan Kuduttar Nenjam Pol Kalanginan Ilangai Vendu. Because that is the paradigm shift that has happened. Maybe borrowers are more comfortably sleeping than the lenders. But we have done certain reforms, and we could, thanks to the almighty intervention and the excellent team, we could turn around the bank, and we have moved from red to black. And I think there is no looking back from here after Canara Bank. First quarter we declared a result of 281 crores profit. And I'm sure that will be positive in the days to come, years to follow. Because it's a 112-year-old rich tradition, culture-oriented institution. And therefore I see no reason how such institutions can be made to fail. I distinctly remember in Satyam exposure, when we were chairing the board meetings in turns, and one of the board meetings I had to chair the proceedings and in the initial stages, and I had to brief the press by convention. So one of the media person asked me, Satyam is a sinking ship and you are all temporary directors nominated by the government. So you are all temporary, how can you do anything or achieve anything? So with all humility at my command, I responded to that journalist saying, we are all temporary in this world, but we can build institutions which are permanent in this world. We can resurrect institutions and then stabilize them and make them excel with eternal existence. So that is what we are all capable of doing. And whatever little I am able to contribute in these roles, be it Satyam or Canara Bank or Sahara, I don't think I am doing it in my individual capacity. I am doing it representing the profession and with all your good wishes and prayers. So therefore I am drawing phenomenal energy in shouldering these responsibilities. So I am not alone, and therefore the collective output is maybe worth noticing by the society and maybe by the regulators and the nation. So therefore, I dedicate whatever little I am able to achieve to the profession of chartered accountancy. Now coming to the topic, in fact when Rajesh wanted me to deliver the inaugural address, I said let it not be just an inaugural address, and gave him this topic myself, because all around you see lot of questions being attributed or challenged towards the profession as to what the auditors are doing. So I thought maybe we should find some answers as part of deliberating on this subject matter. And the trust and credibility of our profession is the hallmark of our profession, and that has to be sustained as long as this profession has relevance, and I am sure it will have relevance for eternity. So from that perspective, let me take you through some of these basic things. You know, these are all known to us, that India, when it got independence in 1947, it took 3 years to become a republic of India. But even before India became republic, the parliamentarians felt this is one profession that needs to be chartered in 1949 itself. So therefore, we are ahead of getting recognized in terms of India's republic attainment. So that shows the significance as to how the profession has been ranked in priority for the government's conferring this chartered status. In fact, if you go through the debates that have happened, you know, some of them vociferously objected to the conferment of chartered designation to our profession. They said only British qualified can be conferred with chartered status. But then there was an equal or maybe more stronger voice from other representatives who said Indian CAs are no inferior to British CAs and therefore they must be conferred with this chartered status, and that's how ultimately it got sanctioned. So from that perspective, you know, the origin of the profession is really glorious and commendable. And we are perceived as the custodians of financial discipline because India, as it is emerging as the largest, fastest growing economy, and it is expected to, you know, it has surpassed France and moved to sixth position, and it will soon surpass UK and move to the fifth position. So thereafter, it is a question of Germany and Japan to move to the third position, and finally it is China and US that will be competing with India. While that appears to be surmountable, that appears to be possible, but you know, the challenging question is, are you, as you are building the economy in the incredible India, are you building a credible economy? So that finance you know, aspect or facet of the economy gains importance, where our profession has to play a significant role. So in that sense, we are custodians of the financial discipline. And as regulatory body, under the Act of Parliament, we were vested with many powers, right from curriculum to examination to standard setting to disciplinary mechanism. And if you look at the last bullet point in the slide, you know, it looks like ICAI will have to coexist with earlier NACAS and now NAFRA, National Financial Regulatory Authority. No doubt, it is kept in abeyance as of now, but looking at what has happened in the developed countries, it seems that the regulatory body of the profession, you know, administering curriculum and ensuring conferment of the qualification, and will be altogether independent from the authority that will monitor and regulate. Maybe that will be representation of the profession, but nevertheless that independence may be there. So that seems to be the attitude and approach. But when India falls into that is a matter of time. But from the professional perspective, I would like to strongly urge each one of us to say that whether it is ICAI that is going to monitor me or NAFRA that is going to monitor me, it doesn't matter as far as I am concerned, because I have my set standards to follow, my code of ethics to adhere to, and my ethical value system to govern me internally and independently. And therefore, I can stand test of verification by any external agency. And when it is so validated and tested by an external agency more than by your own parent body, maybe your value for the society, your credibility, your trust will go up phenomenally. So from that positive dimension, let us not have any apprehension about all these things, because this seems to be inevitable at some point of time or the other in the future. And morality cannot be legislated. If morality cannot be legislated and crimes can be prevented, then when US enacted Sarbanes-Oxley Act, after that there should not have been any frauds at all. But whereas after Sarbanes-Oxley Act, the frauds were of bigger magnitude. So what does it show? You cannot legislate morality, but you can conduct can be regulated. And that is what is being done with reference to our profession also, because actually good people don't need laws and conduct rules to tell you what you should do, what you should not do. Similarly, bad people, will always find ways and means how to circumvent law and the rules. So from that perspective, in every walk of life, there may be some black sheep. But if they are appropriately handled, then the rest of the profession also will get that goodwill that this is a profession well regulated. So from that perspective, let us view this point and look at this. Now moving to the significance of the audit function, because that is the core area. Now we have moved to tax, and in tax, direct, indirect, and in direct you have international, domestic, so on and so forth. So many sub-branches are there. Even in audit, so many types of audits are there. But the ultimate, the credibility and trust is within the context of the audit function that we do. And this is exclusively given to our profession. Like statutory audit or tax audit for that matter. No other professional is eligible or competent to do these kind of exclusive assignment given under the statutory law. That shows that this is the profession which has gone through a disciplined training mechanism and a blend of practical exposure vis-a-vis the academic orientation, and therefore this is the only competent profession. So this exclusivity, the responsibility upon each one of us to ensure that it is preserved and it is not diluted way forward. The regulatory mechanism, the oversight body, all that can undergo a change. But what this profession is capable of doing, no other profession is competent to do. That message should be loud and clear, and that can be loud and clear only when the assigned to us is shouldered with appropriate measure of dignity and competence. And in terms of accountability, I'm not demeaning any other profession for that matter. Every profession is a noble profession. But in terms of accountability, I'll just pick out one facet of accountability and demonstrate as to how wider is the spectrum of our accountability. If you talk about a medical professional operating on a patient, doing surgery on a procedure on a patient, maybe that medical professional for that exercise of that professional expertise is accountable to that patient and the kith and kin. Maybe law, any person who is rendering services, legal services, in representing before the court, maybe is accountable to his client and also to the court as officer of the court. And maybe in terms of architect who has designed a building like this, is accountable not only to the client who has engaged him to design this building, but also to all the users of this building for the future safety and all those other allied matters. So accountability is to a larger spectrum. In that sense, if you look at an auditor who has attested the financial statements of a listed company, which might be listed across the geographies, what is the spectrum of accountability? It is phenomenally wider than any of these professionals' accountability, because you are accountable not only to the shareholders, but also to the lenders, to the depositors, to the investors across the globe, to the regulators, to the government. You name any section of the market, everybody it is possible that they'll rely upon the integrity of the data, only because it is attested by a chartered accountant. Unknown face from any remote corner of the world can rely upon your signature and therefore take significant decisions running into millions and billions. So that is the wider horizon in which we are operating and discharging this function, and therefore that recognition certainly comes with a responsibility. And it is therefore our duty to ensure the credibility and reliability of our attest function, and any compromise on quality has two significant complications or consequences, unpalatable. One is the personal in terms of disciplinary action. The other one is the damage it can cause to the overall goodwill of the profession. More and more instances erupt and get publicized, and especially today's world, the negative news gets so much sensationalized by the media, and also it spreads so fast in the social media that it can reach from one end to the other end of the world in no time in multiple groups. So therefore the image tarnishing happens instantaneously. So from that perspective, on the personal account, you know, what needs to be avoided is the gross negligence and alternatively the dereliction or complicity in any of the frauds or irregularities that happen. And no doubt today's scenario, there is an expectation gap. Society expects a lot because whenever any fraud is reported, the first question they ask is what the auditors are doing. But that is because on the wrong notion that audit is aimed at detecting frauds or the audit's objective is to detect frauds, which is not the real case. But at the same time, the changing scenario, the way the, you know, technology involved frauds are all happening, we cannot claim excuse. If we had followed the basic fundamental steps of auditing, like reconciliation, right from bank reconciliation to other reconciliations, and we have looked at third party confirmations, you know, directly getting obtained, like this, there are many fundamental procedures for audit. If that has been followed, this fraud would have surfaced, could have been detected. If that scenario, how can you claim that audit is not intended to detect fraud? So that is where performance gap can be bridged. If you are able to elevate the level of performance and efficiency by adhering to the standards and the procedures, and thereby if the insights given in the report are giving value addition to the stakeholders, that is where the expectation of gap also can get bridged. So in that sense, I would urge that that aspect needs to be kept in mind. Having discussed the overview about the assurance function significance, on statutory audit, you know, what needs to be most important, I have highlighted in this slide, where the, I would like to, you know, dwell upon only one aspect, that is the documentation, within bracket I have given as working papers. And this applies not just to statutory audit alone. I'm dealing with it because that is what is capturing the attention of the society in the present day debates and deliberations. But this applies to every facet of our profession. Whatever services we deliver to the client, right from engagement to the raising of the bill, whatever transpires between you and the client, even in terms of mail exchanges, on what queries you raised, what services you rendered, everything needs to be documented. I'll give you a typical example, taking maybe about 5 minutes. When I was in the disciplinary committee as a council member, way back in 2003 and 4, there was a complaint from Sachin Tendulkar alleging misconduct on the part of his chartered accountant. The summed substance of the allegation is that the chartered accountant has raised a phenomenal bill of 35 lakhs. For certain services rendered, which is unethical, something like that. I mean, the billing is unethical. See, when anybody alleges this, then automatically the proceedings are set in motion, and the chartered accountant was asked to represent himself. And then, after all the preliminary stages were over, the hearing had to happen. So we were hearing both the parties. Sachin Tendulkar was represented by a senior advocate in Mumbai who came with 6 or 7 juniors, because for him it was an important case in terms of his publicity as a professional, and those 7 juniors were bringing bulk volumes of books. I have not seen them opening it, but maybe to give frighten the bench. So they came, and Sachin Tendulkar was accompanied by his brother Ajit Tendulkar, his wife Anjali Tendulkar, and Ravi Shastri came as a witness. So many things happened in the course of proceedings. But let me tell you, what came as a defense to the chartered accountant in that case, though it has nothing to do with audit, it was more of managerial services, of vetting the documents which secured the services of Tendulkar to various corporates for advertising their products and services, for modeling and posing and publicizing their products. So he was rendering that kind of a consultancy by vetting the agreements, discussing with the parties and making modifications in the contract, so on and so forth. And therefore we asked a simple question to Sachin Tendulkar: why did you not fix the fee before this assignment is given, which would have avoided all this misunderstanding and allegations. And on behalf of Sachin Tendulkar, because he did not know anything other than cricket, so his brother answered saying, we thought for every service he rendered, he was charging 3,000, 5,000, 10,000. It was in thousands. For this also, we thought it would be in thousands. We never expected this 35 lakhs bill to come. We asked the chartered accountant, why you did not fix the predetermine the fee before accepting this assignment or start rendering the assignment? He said, for every service I was rendering, I was simply sending the bill after the service was completed and they were simply paying. So I thought for this also I'll send the bill and they'll pay. You know, this is how each one was operating on their perception. My experience, I mean, if I can share, what I have experienced is the value of services of a professional is 200% before you start accepting the assignment and rendering the services. The moment you start rendering the service, it goes for a discount. And after you complete rendering the service and hand over everything, it goes for a toss. That is some reality, ground reality. In fact, I always believe, and I used to wonder whether billing a client is a art or a science. Actually, billing is a science, because scientifically you will have to capture all the components that get into the billing pattern in terms of hours, man days, experience, hierarchy, deputed, all those things, expertise. So it is a science. Recovering fee is a art. That I agree. So that is how you will have to view it. So in this, after all deliberate, but as I said, the defense for the chartered accountant was 7 volumes of paperwork that he submitted to the bench, disciplinary bench. In fact, let me tell you, after going through all the 7 volumes of paper books, I felt he should have charged at least 2 crores, not just 35 lakhs. I would have done that. So then I was interested as a junior post member of the bench then, I was interested in the responsibility of passing the judgment. And therefore I wrote or captured all the arguments either side and all. Then when it came to the conclusion part, I simply said, you know, billing here, this summon substance is kind of a billing of 35 lakhs for certain services rendered. That allegation can be validated holding the professional as guilty only if the chartered accountant or the professional concerned has raised the bill without rendering services or by misleading that he has rendered X service, whereas he has really rendered Y service kind of a thing. So that can be misconduct, because misconduct is other misconduct also. But in this case, it is about the dispute about the quantum. The client believes that the value of service is worth maybe in thousands. The professional believes it is worth in lakhs or millions. So that is the difference of opinion. And then I wrote a theory or a concept analogy saying, suppose this pen is manufactured for 10 rupees. Now, cost of manufacture of this pen is 10. Suppose this is sold in a private shop for 15 rupees with profit margin, then price is a matter of policy. Cost is a matter of fact, price is a matter of policy. Suppose government gives this pen for 5 rupees to school students, by subsidizing it, again price is a matter of policy, whether you, what is the objective motive behind you are pricing it. So while, you know, cost is a matter of fact, price is a matter of policy, value is a matter of opinion. I perceive this pen is worth nothing because I have enough number of pens, I don't need it. Even if it is given free, I may hesitate because it will occupy some space. If it is used by a celebrity and therefore it is put to auction, maybe somebody will buy this for 1 lakh. So it's a value is a matter of opinion. So in this case, the professional, considering the volume of work done, and I also recorded the fact that the net result of the work done by the professional in vetting all the documents was crystallized, based on which Tendulkar could perform in those shootings. The net revenue earned by Sachin Tendulkar is 204 crores. That is the earnings by the client, where the professional has taken a part in rendering services. So, though that has no direct significance, but I wanted it to be documented. And finally, I went on to say, while the professional felt it is worth, the services are of the value of 35 lakhs. Tendulkar believed it is not so. It is a simple matter of civil dispute. It has nothing to do with ethical principles or code of conduct. And therefore, the Chartered Accountant is held not guilty. So that is how the verdict was rendered. And of course, as expected, the advocate of Tendulkar challenged it before Bombay High Court, and Bombay High Court dismissed the appeal. So that is how the point I am trying to say is not for these peripheral matters, but the point that everything that we need, we do, need to be documented. There are many questions asked to the management when you do many of the services. Replies are given, but later when somebody asks what questions you asked, what replies you got, there is no proof. There is no document evidencing all this, which can become dangerous. So that is the simple point I thought I will highlight using this opportunity. And moving further down, of course, this is a quick glance. I'm not going to deal with all of this. You know, our ICAI also has been, giving all these standards and upgrading. I think this is blocking your view, isn't it? It is doing its own editing. So subject to that, I think we'll understand. So the kind of points that needs to be captured, the format that needs to be, everything is undergoing change depending on the requirement. And current scenario, that brings us to the current scenario. See, Companies Act has brought in rotation of auditors, because there have been corporates where the auditors, statutory auditors, were carrying on the audit for almost three decades, four decades before enactment of Companies Act 2013. And lawmakers believe rotation will secure more independence and break the so-called nexus between auditors and management. So that has come to stay. And in terms of reports, we can give unmodified report with or without emphasis of matter. We can give modified reports where you can qualify the report, you can have a disclaimer to the report, in the report, and you can even express adverse opinion in the report. All the three are possible. But in addition to these, one more trend is noticed in the current year, especially after PNB fraud and few other frauds that have surfaced. We notice resignations are also happening. Instead of signing, auditors are resigning. So that trend, in fact, 1 month ago I googled and saw the statistics as to how many auditors have resigned. It was talking about 30 auditors have resigned. But recently I googled and found out 205 auditors, or I mean little over 200, have resigned from listed company auditors position. There was a comment saying that yes, auditors are now standing up to their demands of furnishing all the material information without which they are refusing to sign, therefore resignations are happening. That is one dimension, I believe. But as a professional, as a member belonging to this noble profession, if it happens as a matter of exception, I can understand it and accept it and maybe applaud. But if it is happening on a larger scale, maybe keeping in mind that this is exclusively assigned to the profession of chartered accountancy, government should not think that this profession is not capable of handling these kind of situations, and therefore they are shying away from handling the responsibility. While resignation by an audit firm under extreme situations may be to prevent their reputational risk of that firm, but if it is done on a larger scale, we are facing the reputational risk of the profession itself. And therefore, that should be a matter of rarity and not a matter of routine resignation. If critical information is not given, I think there are ways and means by which it can be obtained. If not, the management is not cooperating, I think we should be able to meet the audit committee chairman or bring it to the notice of the audit committee and bring the management around. Otherwise, what will happen? There are some situations where Last 6 years you have signed, this year you are resigning. Then how, what happened in the last 6 years? How cooperation turned out to be, that question will come. Another danger is, one audit firm is resigning on 24th, another audit firm is signing on 30th. How in 6 days, another firm is able to get cooperation, whereas you, you know, because again, it's all your colleagues who are going to get into your place. So it has to be a well thought out, thorough analysis that needs to be done before any extreme step is resorted to. And I did mention about these kinds of frauds and all that, and Companies Act expects us to report fraud beyond a monetary limit, and SFIO, you know, chapter is also revamped in Companies Act. And Kotak, Uday Kotak was the chairman of Kotak Governance Committee, which has made a lot of recommendations. One of the recommendations is that Risk Management Committee should factor in cyber security as part of its diligence in the course of transacting the agenda and business. And data analytics, artificial intelligence have come to stay, are disrupting the way things are being done, but we'll have to embrace it to be successful in this field. And changes are happening on a day-to-day basis. All of us know that. You know, on the domestic front, there are changes. 20 years ago, if you had asked a housewife to decide on the smallest matter, she would have said, I need to consult my husband. Today, every husband says the same thing. I need to consult my wife. Isn't it? See, when children, when we used to go to children, school as children, our parents used to frequent the school to ask the teachers, how is my son studying, how is the daughter studying. Today, for parent children teachers meet also, there is a proxy who goes. And parents don't seem to have time, and parents are asking the children at home, how is the teacher teaching, all right, or you want a change. You know, there is a paradigm shift. On the social front, again there is a sea change, how things are happening. We used to write diaries every night and keep it confidential. Even our siblings cannot peep into it, because it's our privacy. But now what youth are doing, what we used to write in the diaries, they are posting in the Facebook. And by end of the day, they want to see how many likes have come for that. You know, the transformation is happening. Even on the business side, I can give any number of examples. Let me give the recent example I have seen. Very simple example. 2 days back, I was having dinner. I mean, board dinner was there in a restaurant in Mumbai. And the surprising fact I came to know was that the restaurant owner doesn't own any of those furniture. Then who owns it? There is a furniture maker, interior designer, who has done the entire furnishing for that very large restaurant. Now customers who come to dine, when they use this furniture and if they like it, they can place order, furniture will be delivered at home. Now the furniture maker has got a free showroom to display his products and to be experienced by the potential customers. The restaurant owner need not invest on the furniture at all. Win-win situation. So this is how the business models are undergoing change. So many disruptions are happening and changes are happening. But what doesn't change, be it 18th century or 21st century, is the fundamentals and the value system that govern each profession, each of our basic human life. And that should not be compromised, that should not change. So now quickly moving on to internal audit, because I feel this inaugural session, by the time I conclude, if I can capture some minds on what is the potential opportunity that is available in Coimbatore, which you have not yet explored, if I can unravel it for your assimilation thought process, my job is done. That is how I have come here. So 1956 Companies Act never spoke about internal audit, I mean as a statutory mandate. But we have in 2013 Act, Section 138, which mandates all listed companies and unlisted public companies based on the paid up capital, based on the turnover, based on the borrowings, based on the deposits, and even private companies based on turnover and borrowings. Mandatory requirement. So, and the phase of internal audit has a dramatic change. Previously, it was simply financial compliance audit. Internal audit was a management function, financial and compliance audit. But today, it has widened in its scope. It has everything to do with the management achieving the organizational goals and objectives. So internal audit can be aligned with that. The risk management is one of the important facets of internal audit. We can give that value addition to the client. Look at the statistics that reveals that if only risk management is adequately factored through internal control mechanism encompassing internal audit, look at what positive impact the businesses can have. You know, 33% plus 42%. Strongly positive, marginally positive, you had more than 70%, 75% of the businesses have experienced. But because there is a strong risk management system, the business performance has gone up with no pilferage or leakage. And similarly, look at where and all internal auditors are getting involved. You know, they are getting involved in new geographical market expansion of the business, mergers and acquisitions, strategic collaborations and alliances. Organically, when you grow and position yourself, that expansion also, and new product and service, because every one of this facet of expanding business, growing business, gives room for risks, variety of risks. And therefore, management, if can align with the internal audit function, I think the business is going to prosper. See, generally, friends, anything a chartered accountant does to a client, suppose statutory audit, what impact financially it has to the client? Audit fees gets debited to the profit and loss account, profit comes down to that extent. To put it in abstract terms, don't mistake me for simplifying it so in a rude manner. But I think internal audit is capable of enhancing the credit side of the profit and loss account for the client by telling him what markets he can explore, how his profitability revenue streams can be augmented, what is the untapped potential, all those things. Internal audit can also give value addition on reducing the debit side of the profit loss account in cost control measures and cost optimization measures, right sizing many of the, you know, including the employees, so on and so forth. So when credit side of the P&L account goes up, debit side of the P&L account goes down. What internal audit costs the business? Maybe only a minuscule of the net, all this aggregate, and therefore the client will also happily pay. You know, in that sense, lot of transformation can happen, and this is the data globally how internal audit uses technology and the attributes of excellence in terms of the internal auditor, though a management function, functioning independently, enhances the value of the stakeholders by strategic collaboration with the goals and objectives of the, in fact, our ICAI definition. ICAI has come out with 18 standards for internal audit. It has also come with, you know, sector-wise technical guide for how to carrying out internal audit. So all that, any young member getting a first time internal audit also can rely upon these things and then successfully emerge out as a specialist. So ultimately, ladies and gentlemen, it is the question of quality and integrity blended that will keep the trust and credibility in the minds of the stakeholders for the profession. And I felt, and Martin Luther King expressed it in his own way, talking about a street sweeper. So if you have to be performing as a street sweeper, the passion, the dedication, the commitment, the competence that you have to nurture and deliver the service should be such that, or it should be at par with the excellence that has been demonstrated by Michelangelo while painting, Beethoven while composing music, and Shakespeare when he wrote the poet. And the heavens of, hosts of heaven and earth should stop and say, here lived a great street sweeper who did his job well. Nothing more can be said than, quoting this on emphasizing on quality. Now, let me quickly take you through some of the data. Where are we? As a profession, 57 years of existence produced 123,000 chartered accountants. Last 12 years has produced 164,000 chartered accountants. So 57% of the chartered accountants have come into the mainstream professional stream in the last 12 years, which means 57% of them must be less than 40 years. or 35 years or so, young population. And how many are in practice, how many are in employment? How many have obtained a certificate of practice? In fact, in the year 2006-07, when I was the president, only 5% of them who passed during that year took the certificate of practice. 95% of them joined employment. That was the... So, look at the what has happened. In at the advent of this century, 71% were in practice, 29% in employment. Now it has become 47% and 53%. But when I say employment, it need not be in industry alone. It can be working in a professional firm also, like Big Four or our audit firms. There are many chartered accountants who are working. They are also falling under no COP mostly. And part-time COP, I have included in the COP statistics. And gender analysis, if I can do. Here again, if you see, first 57 years up to 2005, 12% was the presence of women chartered accountants. In the last 12 years, it has more than doubled. It has become 25% in the last 12 years. 12% has become 25%. And I analyzed the data of the students, girl students, men students, boys, though I'm not sure about the overall accuracy and at given point of time, but I find at least 38% of them must be girl students. While parliament is still debating on 1/3 for women, our profession has surpassed that quietly. There are 38% of the girl students doing CA. And how many firms are there? How many are proprietary practitioners? You know, out of 71,000 practicing units, about 50,000, about 60,000 are proprietors or two partner firms. The next two, I would say, as mid-size, you know, 3 to 5 and 6 to 9, you know, you have about 10,000 of them, mid-size firms. But 10 to 20 and 21 to 30, 31 to 139, if you add, it comes to 444. This is, I would call it as a big segment. Big firms. For the standards of our country, we can safely call them into the third category. Now the point is, every segment is required for the economy. Because even on the business or in the market space, you have all, you know, categories of business houses who need the services. So small operators are there, MSME is there. Startups are there. So therefore, every segment of this firm is essential for the economy. But only thing is, last year, 1st July, Prime Minister in the CADA address, he said, why should there be only Big Four globally? Why not there be Big Eight? And out of the Big Eight, why not the remaining four be Indian firms? So Indian Big Four. So that is how he conceptualized and spoke towards the end of his speech. But I am conceptualizing not just Big Eight. Okay, since Prime Minister said, I was put in the caption Big Eight, but stroke, my dream is there should be Big 20. And Big 20 dominated by Indian firms. And is it possible? I feel these 444 firms whose breakup I have given here are capable of reaching to that level. Any one of these 444 firms can occupy the top 20 slot. It can happen. So that is how I perceive it, because, you know, after this about 20 partner was not possible before 2013 at all. Only when the new Companies Act came and Section 11 of the old act got deleted, the relaxation came beyond 20 partner in a firm. So therefore this has become possible. So in the last 5 years, 2013 the liberation happened, shackles got removed. Now 2018, in the last 5 years, look at how many have surpassed, 36 firms have surpassed this limit of 20 partners, isn't it? So we have done impressively well, and we will do much better in the days to come. So from that perspective, I think we have a bright future and presence. Now this is the expanding horizon on the professional front, services, variety of services that are emerging related to technology. Because finance knowledge in the team designing the softwares or developing software is very, very critical. And similarly, you know, I will not highlight everything. Serial number 3, IBC code, insolvency and bankruptcy code. As on today, 1,800 resolution professionals are registered with the insolvency and banking board bureau. And more, and there is phenomenal scope because thousands of cases are getting flooded to NCLT. And so insolvency professionals, chartered accountants can emerge out as successful insolvency professionals. So that is long-term synergy you can have in that sense. Similarly, you know, in terms of you know, GST in India and VAT in Middle East, and serial number 9, I want to emphasize, women CAs can be potential independent directors on the boards of listed companies and top companies where one woman director is mandatory. Companies Act simply said one woman director. So what has happened, many of the family-owned companies, the promoter family ladies have become and fulfilled that requirement. Now Kotak, you know, recommendation says one independent director should be a women director. So promoter family ladies will not be counted in future as it comes to, so there is a phenomenal opportunity for women CAs if they can groom themselves, nurture themselves, not only they can become independent directors way forward. And once you are on the board, automatically being a chartered accountant, you will be also asked to become the chairperson of the audit committee. So that role and responsibility we should be able to gear up. And the last but one, 11, virtual CFO services. Many of us, I mean many of these MSMEs, MSME definition again is changing. It is up to now based on investment in plant and machinery or assets, the definition of, and therefore manufacturing company SME definition was different, service sector MSME definition was different because service sector may not require that much investment. That was point number one. Point number two, investment made in 1960s and present day MSME constituted the investment made. You cannot compare and equate. So cabinet disbanded with that definition, and now the new definition they are giving is turnover definition. Just as GST has synergized both products and services, MSME definition also synergized, whether you are in manufacturing sector or service sector, it doesn't matter. Turnover up to 5 crores, micro. 5 crores to 75 crores, small. 75 crores to 250 crores, medium. So that is the definition, new definition of MSME. So for all of them who cannot afford to have a full-time CFO, a practicing chartered accountant can virtually play the role of a CFO, not as on the payrolls, as a consultant, as an advisory position. 10 organizations you can pick up and set up the systems which will generate the MIS on a monthly basis or weekly basis, and based on those insights and data analytics you can play the role of a CFO. And we are administering law compliance of all the clients, so therefore it will not be all that difficult to give a template and checklist and ensure that these MSMEs also fall in line with the right side of the law. So these are all the things. And in terms of whether you are a proprietary or two partner firm or 139 partner firm, whatever be the size, I think all of us have to address on this succession plan. We need to, you know, position ourselves as the best employer when it comes to our staff, best trainer when it comes to our students doing articleship under us. And that builds the individual reputation, goodwill, and which augments to the professional goodwill on a larger scale. And every, you know, team member's social needs and stature needs to be guided by the firm. And we need to groom and nurture leadership. You know, we have many senior chartered accountants here. If in our firm, as I mean, if you are not growing and you want to position as a small firm, fine. But if you have the aspiration to grow and build a leadership, I think an ideal firm, even a mid-sized firm, will be well, you know, well placed if they have partners in the 60s, partners in the 50s age group, 40s, 30s. You know, that kind of a hierarchy, if it can be built even in a medium-sized firm, it will have the eternal, I mean, as I put it in the last point, eternal existence and sustained excellence. And we can transform the human resources aspirations into accomplishments. I think that as seniors we should be able to do. And other things are you know, aligned to this, you know, adopting and practicing the best of practices and promoting health and happiness and focusing on intangibles, because that will work, will sustain us in the long run. The intangibles, if they are preserved, tangibles will automatically follow. Top line, net worth, turnover, all that will automatically be a consequence or byproduct of the preservation of intangibles like goodwill, reputation, brand image, quality of services, customer satisfaction, all those things if they are taken care of. So these are the thoughts. I made up my mind, whatever time I am given the mic, I will conclude by 11 o'clock. So 1 minute is left. So my prayers, I mean, I am amazed at the way Coimbatore branch sustains its active conducting of programs both for members and students. I think that is because the seniors are grooming year again succession plan. Youngsters are taking up leadership position like Rajesh and his predecessors who have done excellent work. I am given to understand in the recent intermediate results that was announced, 5 rank holders from Coimbatore. So students are also excelling. So I, on this occasion, I only greet all of you and pray that you know, may the Almighty bless you with the strength to change things which need to be changed, the serenity to accept things which cannot be changed, and the wisdom to know the difference. Thank you very much.